Special coverage on KCPT of the Greater Kansas City Chamber's Big Five initiatives is funded by Burns & McDonnell, with additional financial support from Swope Community Enterprises, and by...
Coming up on this week's local show, it's a dirty job, but someone has to do it. A closer look at an important business that enables you to, well, do your business anytime, anywhere.
Narrowing down a site for a new UMKC downtown arts campus.
Reaching out to veterans at the World War I Museum.
And celebrating the spirit of the spirit at the Paris of the Plains Cocktail Festival.
Principal funding for the local show provided by Francis Family Foundation, Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kaufman Foundation, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Hall Family Foundation, Johnson County Community College. Additional support provided by and KCPT members. Thank you.
And I'm Nick Haynes, and welcome to the local show. They've narrowed it down to three.
Three sites, that is, for UMKC to build a new downtown arts campus that would include room for its Conservatory of Music and Dance, but also space for its theater and other arts programs. This was one of the Big Five ideas advocated by the Greater Kansas City Chamber of Commerce last fall.
Even though the UMKC Conservatory has been a part of Kansas City's cultural life for over 100 years, many of us still know very little about this hidden jewel working hard to raise its profile both here and across the country. In fact, our story starts on a March night in New York City.
First, when Dinwiddie asked me to play a piece by Chen Yi and said there's a possibility we're going to take this to New York, it was huge because I've never actually played in New York before. I got to collaborate with Jim Snell and Nick Petrella. It was a great experience to work with faculty.
It was a night that Philip Lazowski won't soon forget. Standing on stage at New York's Poisson Rouge, in the company of fellow students from the UMKC Conservatory, and a who's who of its illustrious faculty, including Pulitzer Prize-winning composer Joe Lone and his wife Chen Yi, electronic music pioneer James Moberly, Paul Rudy, and renowned tenor Vincent Cole.
Color them green.
We were committed to taking music from Kansas City to New York City. About 30 civic leaders and arts leaders came with us and had an experience in New York City that was really terrific.
A performance like this can heighten a school's visibility, but what most people won't see are the preparations that make it possible. In a sense, the conservatory teaches 15,000 music and dance lessons a year. As its dean, Peter Witte compares it to work done in the kitchen to prepare a great meal for the dining room.
This facility was built when we had 300 students or so at the conservatory. We're now at 527, and we're simply bursting at the seams.
Let's see some seams.
Absolutely. So this is one of our piano practice rooms, and it's cozy.
Let's do the math here. 7-foot piano.
6-foot room.
So the challenge in each of the rooms is pretty significant. And then there's the challenge that we simply don't have enough of the rooms. Getting a practice room here at the conservatory is a little bit like getting an apartment in Manhattan. A lot of magic happens here. This is Bobby Watson's office. For Bobby, I think the opportunity to come back to Kansas City was the right opportunity at the right time. The challenge was, in order to make a space for Bobby, we needed to take down a wall and then lose two practice rooms.
He gets to come back to this.
Well, yeah. It's what we have, and we're making it work. And here we have one of our dance studios. And we have two, we really should have four.
This is where we're placing all of our costumes and all of the things that people don't think are part of making a production possible. And every square inch is taken up.
For years now, UMKC's White Recital Hall has been the place for students to formally reveal the skills they've developed. Last spring, it was the site for a master class in conducting with Michael Stern from the Kansas City Symphony.
Every half bar, every quarter note is something else. You have to be that. It's not that you have to show everything, but you have to be everything. Okay? So try one more time, measure 13.
But the arrival of a world-class performance hall some 5 miles away is beginning to change the game. And Peter Witte has been quick to seize the opportunity.
We have been challenged for quite some time seeking a solution for space. The thing that is possible, though, is if you turn a problem sideways, it can become an opportunity.
In its first year, Helzberg Hall has hosted groups from the conservatory playing everything from the Carmina Burana to the Gates Barbecue Suite. For students and faculty, the idea of a spacious new home just down the street from such an amazing facility is hard to resist.
It's one of the coolest venues I've ever been in. It's beautiful, the acoustics are wonderful, having played there. You want to contribute to the greatness of the place. If it's our conservatory, it's closer to that building, you know, then we have linked everything.
Imagine students at UMKC of all majors being in courses that bring them to Helzberg Hall, bring them to the Kauffman Center, bring them to 18th and Vine. In the 20th century, that was an arts appreciation course. In the 21st century, imagine what's possible here.
The concept of a downtown arts campus connected to a cultural icon has good precedents. Juilliard and the Lincoln Center, the Eastman School in Rochester, and a few more recent examples in Phoenix and Columbus, Georgia. And of course, there are challenges, big ones, like the cost, with initial estimates starting at $50 million and up, and where it would go. To get that ball rolling, 12 locations were selected for review, from the West Bottoms to the Jazz District. Not surprisingly, the Crossroads, that area just south of downtown, revitalized by artistic activity, is getting lots of the attention.
They have everything.
Susie Aaron has seen some amazing changes here over the last 15 years. A UMKC graduate, she believes that wherever the school might land, an influx of smart, motivated 18 to 35-year-olds could only be good news for downtown and the business community.
Everyone would understand the value of bringing in large companies from different cities, but to bring a large company with new buildings and renovated buildings, I think they fit right in, and I think people get that. From the real estate point of view, density is what we're all striving for.
Following further study, the field of 12 has been narrowed now to 3, each with its own pros and cons. Site number 1, Barney Alice Plaza, could hardly be more central. Sitting atop the auditorium parking garage means that any facility built on it would require all new construction.
It's sort of in a business and hotel district. It isn't necessarily the most campus option of the three, but this is a spot that's anchored in Kansas City's history. We have the municipal auditorium right here behind us, the Folly, one of the great theaters here with a great legacy. What drives us is doing right by our students. So we're giving concerts primarily for the people who are on stage. We can take some of the off nights in some of these facilities, a Monday or a Tuesday evening, which is a non-revenue night. And so there's a real symbiosis here that we see strengthening both the environment downtown, but also the connections among the arts organizations here in Kansas City.
Turning east from the Kauffman Center, site number 2 hugs the hillside that slopes down to Main Street, where transit already connects to the Volcker campus. And this northern edge of the Crossroads blends vacant lots with industrial structures well-suited to various kinds of artistic reuse.
In our initial studies, which are all preliminary, we want to make certain that we have this terrific balance between some of the new spaces that we might need, but also some really creative adaptive reuse. Then you have this terrific neighborhood in Crossroads where art and food and technology are all intersecting, and it's almost a perfect laboratory for our students.
They can get a cup of coffee with musicians from the Kansas City Symphony. They can see members of the Lyric Opera and the Kansas City Ballet at lunch. I mean, there's a real power there.
Just up the hill and a block or two south, site number 3 takes its cues from Broadway. And more of the warehouses, storefronts, and empty spaces that could be shaped into an accessible and attractive corner campus.
We know that Julie Irene Kaufman and the Kaufman Center wanted to be a catalyst for development here in Kansas City. When you're talking about adaptive reuse, a rehearsal hall is a large box. You don't need a whole lot of infrastructure inside of that box necessarily. Some of the spaces require a little bit more complexity, but we do need some very large spaces. This year's freshman retires in 2060, so how do we prepare that student for their future? We know that every artist is going to have a portfolio career. They're going to be a teacher, they're going to be a performer. We hope that they write about music. And so part of that is green space, part of that is being in the community. All of those things are part and parcel of being a whole person.
People from New York showed up, and people that I've never met, you know, and they come, they congratulate you, and they really hear about the conservatory. Oh, you go to Kansas City. Well, I never thought that Kansas City has a good conservatory. Well, we do.
We don't have mountains, we don't have oceans, but we really have a strong cultural community. I mean, we bring in lots of dollars, we employ lots of people, and I think that's where Kansas City is today.
What would a UMKC downtown arts campus mean culturally and economically to this city? You can join UMKC and top civic and arts leaders in a panel discussion at the Downtown Library Wednesday, September 5th at 6:30. You can get the details at our webpage, thelocalshow.org. Next on The Local Show, we head to the National World War I Museum in Kansas City, which not only houses artifacts and memorabilia, it is also a tribute to the service and commitment of veterans of all conflicts. KCPT producer Pam James visits with museum volunteer and Vietnam veteran Philip Mall to learn more about how this special place honors service members and the experiences they share.
When I first came here as a volunteer, I had a lot of time sometimes to go around and look at the exhibits and read everything and study up on this. And I was struck that all wars are somewhat similar. All the people that fight in them really don't want to be fighting there. They don't. But they're there because their country called, patriotism. My undergraduate degree was in history, and I studied World War II and Korea, and of course Vietnam I lived through, and I was amazed at how similar they were, how brutal they were. But this one resonates because I think it personifies the sacrifice that men and women gave. When I read some of the stories that are here, and you just look at the pictures of the people, and in some cases how dog-tired they look and how beat up they look, it really opens up your eyes to that. This was a war that I think personifies all the wars we're in. Hi, folks. Is this your first visit to the museum?
Yes.
Where are you from?
Tucson, Arizona.
Tucson, Arizona, great place. It's somewhat easy to spot the veteran. They'll either have a ball cap on that says veteran, or they're older. And you look at somebody my age or older, you can say, chances are he serves. And so you can ask. To a person, they comment on how well done the museum is. And it brings back some emotions to them. And I've had them comment that they thought that this war seemed to be dirtier, muddier, nastier than the war they fought in. The Walk of Honor struck me the minute I walked into the new museum. When you look at all those names, all the different branches of service, and you look at the names, and it's a potpourri of any ethnic group you want to think of, any race is there. I think people want to be remembered, and honored for their sacrifice. In fact, before we even went through the museum, my wife and I went out and bought a brick. And they said, what do you want to put on it? And I said, well, I'm going to put my name, but I want my wife's name too. And they said, did she serve? I said, yeah, she served at home. she made it easier for me when I was over there. The four guardians that are on the tower, you got patriotism, sacrifice, honor, and courage. And the one that strikes me the most, frankly, is sacrifice. How all the people sacrificed. And how in other wars, if you'll look, the sacrifice that went on. And I would hope that as a nation, we never forget those who sacrificed it all for our freedom.
Some of Kansas City's top bartenders are participating this weekend in the Paris of the Plains cocktail competition.
It's just one event in Kansas City's week-long cocktail festival now underway that blends all sorts of spirited dinners, contests, seminars, industry gatherings, and culminates Monday in the Paris of the Plains Gala, a benefit for KCPT, a big party with live music, dancing, handcrafted cocktails, and food at the American restaurant.
Joining us are two key figures from the Paris of the Plains Soiree, the American restaurant's general manager, Jamie Jameson, and former Manifesto bartender, Brandon Cummings.
What is Paris of the Plains?
There was a journalist for the Omaha Herald, Edward Murrow, different from Edward R. Murrow, which most people assume, that was quoted saying, if you want to see some sin, forget Paris, go to Kansas City. This really dates back to the Jazz Age and the era when Kansas City was basically staying wet. A lot of thanks to Tom Pendergast and Boss Tom's influence here. Basically, we had more liquor stores, more bars still running during the Prohibition and Jazz era, and thankfully that birthed jazz and barbecue, and that's where we kind of derive Paris of the Plains from.
We are talking about a competition, though, that involves bartenders, right? When you say competition, it's actually centered around, and I'm trying to picture, what do bartenders do when they compete?
This is not a flair competition. This isn't about how fancy you can make your drinks, you know, look. It's really ultimately about the flavors. It's really about, are you thinking about specific ingredients and using fresh ingredients, using quality ingredients, much like a chef would treat a gourmet dish. So they're being judged based upon that, as well as they're competing upon their knowledge for history. You know, Doug Frost is, you know, he's an encyclopedia of knowledge, especially when it comes to spirits and food and beverage history. And so he calls out questions like, what are the different aging methods for Armagnac? Or, you know, name me five production regions or, you know, specific varietals used in Champagne. Or, you know, and so he'll call out some pretty difficult questions. And so they get rated on stage, performing in front of a live audience on the cocktail they're creating, as well as they have to make a classic cocktail that will be called on the fly to them, as well as how they present all of this. And they have to produce their classic their original recipe in a batch quantity for 200 guests.
Hey, speaking of performance art, you guys did indeed cook up some pretty intriguing drinks. And I think we ought to just share with people how you put together what you've brought to the local show. So let's take a look.
We're going to be making the Norhattan, which is a variation on the classic Manhattan. The big variation on this is that we're using the Norton grape, thus the Norhattan, made with Stonehill Norton, which is a local winery here in Missouri, which we're very proud of. The basic Manhattan always starts with bourbon. And we're just going to put 1 ounce and 2 ounces. And then you have 2 ounces of Stonehill Norton, which is adds a little fruitiness to it. And then just to add a little bitterness, you always have a vermouth that makes a Manhattan, and that's a 1/2 ounce of Carpano, and then barrel aged bitters. You just put 2 little drops in there, and we'll put a little ice. This is a drink you just want to stir. And then we just strain it into a beautiful cocktail glass. Now, Manhattan usually has cherry as a garnish, but we are going to use orange. It goes much better with the fruitiness of the Norton. You just take a little fire and spurt the oils in there, and you have a beautiful Norhattan.
All right, the Norhattan cocktail. And, you know, I'm looking down this list of things that are going to be happening. There's a gala that comes to the aid of KCPT, among other things.
The whole idea was that
everything leads up to the gala. And we look at the history of Kansas City, and it is about jazz, it is about the speakeasy, and it's about celebration of community as well. And who better to partner with than KCPT? We've got a fantastic band. It's going to be Black Tie. We've got all the competitors, or some of the competitors, plus the local talent from Kansas City that's going to be making have bartending stations. And then there's also a new thing that we're working on, which is the Washington Cup. President George Washington was a distiller, and as an ode and a tip of your hat to Washington and to brother with the Jefferson Cup is a spirits competition. So you'll be able to vote and be part of the Washington Cup. So with cocktail stations, Chef Debbie Gold will be making a plethora of dishes to go with cocktails as well.
Obviously, KCPT, very glad that you've take it upon yourselves to help partner with us. We believe we're worth it, and we're worth lifting a glass too. So thanks for coming down, making a drink on our behalf, and making the efforts that will pay hopefully big dividends for us when it's the Paris of the Plains Festival. Thank you, guys.
Excellent. Thank
Cheers.
You.
And finally this week, we move along to a story where we flesh out the details behind a stinky situation. With Labor Day just around the corner and a slew of late summer outdoor festivals getting underway, producer Rich Miller takes us behind the dirty business of an underappreciated Kansas City amenity. We're talking about the Port-o-potty.
You know, when I was in high school, I never ever thought I'd be doing this.
You and me both.
Really, the only thing you could sum up the port-o-potty business in one sentence: we're number one in the number two business. I mean, you know, everybody teases about how to do it, but we got to have it. You can't have outdoor events or events away from public services without having some way to let the public go to the bathroom. So, with that said, it's a good business if you know what you're doing. Everybody has this built in their head of dealing with sewage. It's a bad deal, but it really isn't. But it's a business that we've got to have. Somebody needs to be done. There's only four of us in town that do it in a metropolitan of a couple million people, so it's not really popular.
Having done a lot of festivals in town, there is certainly a science to putting and ordering port-o-potties. How you line them and how you put them so that people know how to line up and you're not getting crisscross of lines and it visually looks like it's not a big madhouse over there. And a lot of times now we'll have backup areas where we'll have a lot of extra porta potties that we bring in just to make sure that we can accommodate those crowds. And then it's a lot of times just shifting the crowd. Amazing how crowds will stand and wait just because they don't want to walk around and try to find the other set of porta potties.
The toilets do have a tendency to draw people to them, and we have actually found people at the ends of events, towards the ends of the events, when everybody's cleaning up, people have found a place to relax and sit, and that's usually in one of our portable Johnny-on-the-spot toilets. At other events, we've actually had people where friends have, they got a little unruly, and friends have put them in the restroom and put a zip tie or lock on mechanism on the doors, and we find them when we come to service a toilet.
I want to tell you about porta potties before marathons, because they are the most disgusting porta potties ever, because people have
nervous stomachs,
and they are the worst porta potties ever.
Guys will go anywhere as long as they don't get arrested. They don't care where they go. So I mean, that's never been a problem. They could be the most disgusting things in the world, and a guy will still go. Women, nope, they'll hold it and wait till they go inside.
I hate them. I won't. I'm going
don't
inside.
Care how good they
them.
Smell or how clean.
Never do I use a porta potty. Never.
A lot of times it's a guess. You know, you have no idea sometimes how many people are going to come to your event. You always hope for more, right? So you try to anticipate and try to judge. However, I've had experiences where a couple years ago, when Irish Fest, we had record-breaking attendance on Sunday evening. We could not have anticipated the crowds that we had, and so therefore I did not anticipate enough porta potties for that evening. And the porta potties, let's just say they got very, very full, and we were very surprised that people were still utilizing the porta potties. And I will tell you, Monday morning, looking at those porta potties was probably enough to make you never want to go in a porta potty again.
It's all about how many units you're going to have out there to handle the supply and demand. And we have charts that shows that. On like a construction job, you're looking at one unit for about every 10 guys. On a general concert, something that event, we generally figure 50 folks to 75 folks to a unit. Now, let's qualify this though. Just having the units there is just having the units there. The key is the service of the units.
Porta potties are absolutely underappreciated. We would not have festivals or outdoor events without them. And I know that people get really upset when there's not enough, and if you're standing in lines, because I think a lot of people associate big events with long lines at porta potties. You can try to anticipate and have plenty there, but in the end, you can't anticipate what crowd levels will be at any given moment.
And the key is having a nice, clean unit and charge it for it. You'll be successful in this business.
Somebody tells me who likes Kenny Chesney anyways. Last one for the day.
Well, I think we'd better wash our hands of this show. That's it for this week's program. I'm Randy Mason.
And I'm Nick Haynes. Remember, you can catch all these stories again online on the KCPT YouTube channel. We'll see you next time on The Local Show.
Principal funding for The Local Show provided by Francis Family Foundation, Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kaufman Foundation, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Hall Family Foundation, Johnson County Community College. Additional support provided by and KCPT members. Thank you. Special coverage on KCPT of the Greater Kansas City Chamber's Big Five initiatives is funded by Burns and McDonnell, with additional financial support from Swope Community Enterprises, and by